take two chairs?
I'm going to push the button to make the video work, so maybe you should just kind of hold your mic and my mic. Because you're pointing to the screen. This is my desktop, which is as far as the back there.
We're going to do this a little differently because I've already talked about most of the skeptics about my book, but Susan had some ideas, and I'm a little conflicted about doing this, so I'm going to be real interested to see what the response is.
Especially since we're filming it.
Kind of good to have people laugh. because this is, for me, I'm not really proud of this, but I have to do it, and Susan's going to explain why, right?
Yes, I will. All right, so while we're working on that for a moment, I will set the stage here. Mark Edward is a mentalist. He is an expert on seance. He performed at the Houdini seance at the Magic House for many, many years. He is one of the experts in his field, which is psychics. And one of the reasons why he has such great insight into the psychic world, the psychic business, is because he has worked as a psychic, and he did it for many years. He has written a book on the psychic business, which is called Psychic Blues. By the way, I took that picture. Oh, and I wanted to point out on that picture earlier that somebody showed up, Leonard showed up behind him bending the spoon. I took that picture. Just saying, you know, as photographers got to get credit where we can. So Mark asked me, what do you want me to talk about at SkeptiCamp this year? And I said, I really want you to talk about a chapter of your book. One of the chapters, and there's so many good books, chapters in here. And he said, well, pick one. And I said, I want you to talk about the moment of truth and the Psychic Friends Revival. If this doesn't have audio, then we're just going to have to wing it, I guess, and we'll also have to act it out.
So should I just tell
Interpretive Dance or Semaphores? Okay. So Mark worked as a psychic for many years. In fact, you can get a psychic reading from him right now.
First of all, let's paint the picture, okay?
Right.
So people understand, because skeptics always get this wrong. They think, oh, you know, what a scumbag, you know? Which I was. But the point is, I was on the editorial board of Skeptic Magazine working with Michael Shermer the entire time I was working as a psychic. And if you don't believe me, you can look at Skeptic Magazine.
Right, front cover.
On the editorial board, you will see my name. I started with Shermer, the first magazine that came out. So I've been in the skeptic community since before Shermer. What was his name? Seckel? Al Seckel. I worked with him. You guys remember him?
Yeah.
Anyway. So I want to make that clear. So I went into this bracket because as a magician, I saw how easy it was for people to make tons of money by pretending that they could, you know, see the future and this and that. And I said, you know what? I am going to write a book someday about this because it's so ridiculous and it's funny in a very dark way. So that's the basic background. So now you have specific questions.
Okay, so come over here so we can pick the camera.
I sit on the floor.
So I think the world's greatest. This is a chapter devoted to something.
Can I tell them what happened?
We'll get right to that. So this is a
All right. Should I just fill it in?
Okay. So
what happened?
Mark's at home working the 900 lines. Remember the 900 lines?
Yeah. You remember Psychic Friends Network with Dionne Warwick?
Right, so a letter arrives in the mail one day, and Mark, go ahead and take it from there.
So, I wanted to get to the bottom of this industry, and you cannot just go up to a psychic and say, hey, how'd you do that? Because it's a very wink-wink, nod-nod business. It's very dodgy. If you're familiar with the carnival, I don't know how many people are, but in the carnival, it's called With It. If you were on the Midway, you were a sailor and you're with your girlfriend and you're trying to impress her by throwing money around, and you go down the Midway and they've got those games where they throw a ring on a Coke bottle and the guy, come on, tell me a pitch, come on over here, buddy, I'll give you an extra ball, you look like a nice guy. Well, if the carny guy notices that the guy's throwing his money around and losing, they'll reach under the stand and they'll get a little bit of chalk on their hand and they'll go up to the guy and go, "Thank you," go over your arm and just come over here. He'll go like, as he's going away from the stand, he'll go, "Hey, you did a good job there, buddy." Now he's put chalk on the guy's back. So now all the rest of the guys on the midway, they see the chalk mark and they know the guy's a spender, right?
Call it a mark?
Now, if you're with it means you walk up to the guy and he comes on to you real strong. "Hey, come on over here, buddy. I'll give you two for free. You just say, "With it." Carnival talk, which is a whole language unto itself, which I don't pretend to know. When you say "with it," that means leave the guy alone. He's either working for the police or he's part of the carnival. So the same thing is true with psychics. You can't just walk up to them and say, "How are you able to tell that lady that her grandmother, blah, 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 had a rose garden," or whatever. So you have to infiltrate, you have to get their confidence and play the game. It takes a long time. But the bottom line is, my background in magic and mentalism allowed me to fool them, because most of the people in the psychic business, and it is a business, they don't know anything about stage presence or magic or mentalism or all the things that go into being able to pretend that you can do the things like I did with the fortune. So I played their game, I won their confidence, and I get this letter in the mail. And it's a red, I'll never forget, it was a red envelope. I thought I was going to be arrested or it was a summons or something. I open it up and it says, "We're looking for the world's best psychic." And I went, here I am. I'm going to do this. I'm going to take this company up on this. And I immediately called the number. I said, "You don't have to look anymore. I am the best." And they said, "Oh, who is this?" And I told them who I was. I knew who I was. They set up an interview, and the rest is history, because my idea was to climb to the top of this mountain. So I made this agreement to myself and everybody else. I said, I am not going to stoop to using mentalism tricks anymore. Now I've got them in the palm of my hand. They think I'm the one or one of them. I was up against 16 other psychics for this position. And even though I didn't use any tricks, they still chose me. Who knows why, okay? So there were three of us, and I was one of the three. But I made this agreement in my heart. I said, I'm not going to use, because that would have been easy. It's so much easier to use tricks than to cast a spell, you know, or whatever these people want to believe you can do. Because when you know the methods, you can recreate the methods, which is what Brandy has done and Houdini has done, and all magicians know how to do it. So that was the bottom line. As I said, you know, I'm not going to use tricks, even though I might be really tempted to do that at some point, another, in order to get to where I wanted to be, which was the top realm of this company, Psychic Friends Network. Now, an important thing to remember, the Psychic Friends Network, this is in the book, they own like 5 or 6 different psychic companies. And they actually, this is a great marketing thing, speaking of marketing, even though they own different companies that have different names, they pitted each one against each other, just like Kellogg's owns several different cereals, and they said, "We're better than the other company." But they're all owned by the same guy. So what they were doing is diversifying out into the market and trying to give people a choice of psychics to go to. And the one that was my favorite was, "We're the only certified psychics." Which was like, who's doing the certifying? It just, that really got to me, because I was like, you get a certificate, what happens? Okay, so
this video hopefully has sound.
So now it comes to the pinch. I won't even go into the meeting the agents and all the horrible people that I had to convince that I was their man. But they said, "You're going to make an infomercial." And the basis of the infomercial, oh, it's going to run good, is that the lowest I have ever seen. We are going to pitch this idea of a psychic revival network. Which means they're going to combine psychic things with a revival tent, right? So they were trying to cash in, they were trying to make yet another brand, same owner of the rest of the companies. Psychic revival meant they're going to move the religion in, you know? And they had, you know, saints come marching in, and it was... So I'm one of the three. A lot of water has gone under the bridge. I am now deep undercover. In fact, I'm a little over my head.
So this is 1996, so no comments about your...
No comments about my hair.
Or the clothing. Just remember where you were, what you were wearing at that same time. So let's see if it's going to give us volume. The volume. Is it my computer that volume's down?
It was working last night.
Well, it worked on my computer, but this is different. So anyway, that makes sense.
So here are the people coming into the camp.
Yeah, we can do this without sound. We can't get sound.
No,
we've
got to have the sound.
No, we
can't do it without the sound. But yeah, there's the band that are playing.
Oh, exactly.
Okay, so these people are all walking in. They're having a great time.
What's the And they're all having a great time. All right, one thing you have to remember here.
Well, what?
All these people that you see marching in are supposed to look like they're your average Joe on the street. These are all paid experts, including, and there's the star of the show, Mel Carter. Do you remember her? Yeah. Susan, it's not working, is it? All right, so there's Mel, and there's they're getting her ready to go on. And so these are all extras and paid to be there. Now here she comes, and she's going to introduce us as her psychic.
Okay, so it seemed really rehearsed, and the people were sitting in specific places. Can you explain that?
Oh yeah. So what happens is all those people that came in there, they were all sitting down like you are sitting in an audience, okay? And she introduces everybody, and then it goes into the pitch about. We'll see here in a second.
No, it's fine. Go ahead.
What happened?
Same video running again. Go ahead.
Why won't it work?
It's just a sound. I don't know.
But it worked last night. You were watching it. Okay, all right. So there you see all those chairs in a row, and they're all walking towards them. Can you stop that, though? So I don't stop it yet. Okay, so they're all sitting down, they're all singing hymns and this and that, and she comes out and she introduces the three psychics, which she referred to as her angels, okay, and we came out. And then we did our pitch, and our pitch was, this psychic network is different than all the rest, because we're family. We want you to think of us as your angels. So they're playing with the religious thing, and she said a little prayer right in the beginning. There's Chris. She was one of the psychics.
Since we don't have audio, I'm just going to show very briefly a picture of Mark talking, and then I'm going to pause it and let Mark tell you kind of what he was saying.
Okay.
So this is Chris. She's talking to Mel right now
about her life.
Yeah,
Chris was really good at pumping people backstage before they came on, which in the mentalist business is called pre-show. That means she has already talked to Mel and found out what's going on in her life. And then she comes out on stage and acts like it's coming from some psychic place.
Okay.
Now here I am. This is my mom.
Sorry.
Play that part.
Okay, so in this...
That's all messed up.
No, it's okay. So...
Can you play that part?
Yeah, I will right now. So, I wanted you to talk about Nell real quick. Is she with it?
Well, see, that's the thing. I think everybody in this program was with it. Everybody here, there wasn't one believer except for some of the people in the audience. That means all the cast, all the crew, the directors, everybody was in on it. But I played dumb because remember, I try to get in above and look down on this. So
do you have everything you need, Mark?
Okay, so here's what happened. So all the audience is assembled. And she says our psychics are going to go out in the audience and give some readings. Now, I was prepared to go out and do just plain cold reading. Are you all familiar what cold reading is?
No.
Hope so. Well, those who are not, cold reading is being able to go in an audience, much like you guys, only I just came in, and making it seem like I know all these things about you, even though I don't know anything about you. And it uses body language, it uses... verbal deceptions. There's a lot of ways to do it, but it's what John Edward uses. All the psychics, or most of the psychics that you see on television, use it because it's the laziest way to get the job done. Then the editor comes in and edits out all the mistakes. All you see are the hits and not the misses. So I was prepared to totally do cold reading because, remember, I made this agreement with my soul that I would not use tricks, which would have been able to make it incredibly accurate. Okay? And we'll get into that in just a second.
The lights go out.
So I'm going to get to that. So we're sitting on the stage, and one of the things I learned from Uri Geller, who is a friend of mine, and I'm not ashamed to say that because I would rather watch Uri work a room than any magician ever that I've ever seen, because he is incredible. He's a scoundrel, but he is the king of the scoundrels. And I appreciate him for it as an artist and a performer, not as an ethical performer, let's put it that way.
Not as a human being.
But one of the things one of the things I learned from Uri, which I really like, is taking advantage of the moment. He's a master at that. Something happens that's unexpected, he takes advantage of it, and he says, I did that. Do you see how the lights went out? I'm sorry, sometimes that happens. It comes from my mind. Who's going to argue with you, you know? So we're on the stage, 300 people in the audience, and we're right in the middle of the show, and suddenly all the power cuts. So I see my opportunity. I don't care. I don't care what any of these people think. So I stand up and I go, I'm really sorry. Sometimes that happens with my mind. And everyone goes, all the people in the front row. And the crew is going, whoa, what? You know, and I said, I'm really sorry, I'm really sorry. So it's kind of like, who's fooling who now? So they're like, power's off. And I'm going, what the hell? You know, to me, myself, I'm saying, what's going on? So we all go backstage, and the director comes out and he goes, oh, we're going to have somebody look at the generator, so this is going to take about half an hour. So everybody, you can leave your seats, but be sure to come back to the same seats you were sitting in. Okay? Because I guess they made it sound like because all the camera angles have already been set up, and since these are all experts that want to hog the light, they want to go back to the chairs they were sitting in, especially the ones in the front, right? So I go backstage, and I go back by the makeup lady, and I'm like dripping in sweat, and I go, where's the water? I feel really faint. The makeup lady looks at me like, you are the biggest bullshit I have ever seen. It was great. She knew. She knew that I had taken advantage of the moment. I didn't know what was going on, but I was trying to just play the audience. What did I care? There were a bunch of frauds. I did not care. So then we're back having a little snack or whatever, and the director comes up to me and he says, Mark, do you have everything you need? And I said, yeah, I'm okay. And he said, no, do you have everything you need to do the job? He says to me, and I'm like, yeah, I'm going to do cold reading. What do you think I'm going to do? And then he turns to these other people who he's talking to, and he looks over at me, and he's like, and I'm like, what's going on, you know? Suddenly this woman steps out, and she's got a big pile of torn-off sheets from yellow pads. And she says, you get to pick three questions that you're going to answer for people in the audience. And I play stupid. I'm like, what do you mean? The director goes, you know what we mean. But now we come to the moment of truth. They wanted me to take questions from people in the audience who had written them down. Somebody had written them down. And then match them up to the people in the audience when I went out to do the reading. So it would be really, really accurate, right? This is what the business of psychics is. And I was playing against form and acting dumb like I was the real thing. The reason why they cut the lights out was because they had set everybody in their seats, and they needed an excuse to go back and ask them. After the lights went out, they went back and asked people, would you like to talk to someone? What's your question for the psychic? Go ahead, write it down right here. So while he's writing, they take it back, they go, thank you, and then they make a little notation on the bottom, guy in the blue shirt with the mustache. So they come up to me, are you following what's going on here? It's fraud, folks, big time. So So I'm like, now the moment of truth. Am I going to cave to what I really should have maybe done, which would be turn around and walk out of there and say, you guys are bullshit? Or am I going to play their game and follow through on it? So it's really like feeling like secret agent or something. I had a choice to make. I knew if I walked out, there wouldn't be really any ending to this other than I'd be a hero for turning down to the skeptic community. But I was like, I gotta follow through on this. So I caved in and I said, okay, give me the three questions. Now they come forward and they tell me, you and Brianna, that's one of the other psychics, are going to go out into the audience. Your chairs are going to have red tape on the bottom of the chairs, going from left to right, from looking out of the audience. Your three questions will be 1, 2, 3. Brianna's will be 1, 2, 3, but hers are going to have blue tape on the bottom of the chair. All right? So now I've taken the bait, I've now turned into a fraudster. It really felt bad because I was like, well, you set this up. You set this up to happen, so you're gonna do this. And later it'll be in the book. That's all, you know, that's all gonna come out. It's gonna come out eventually, play through. So I come back out, everybody's there, the band fires up, da 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 da, you know, and I come out and they go, now Mark and Brianna are going to go out in the audience. So Mark, you go first. So I walk out, I look for the piece of red tape. The woman's wearing a red shirt, right? Like when they set up the questions, I don't know how they did it, but they color-coded the people wearing red for me and the people wearing blue for her. So how could we miss it? So of course my reading is really accurate, and I wish you could show that. Because
that's okay. We're acting out. Tell them how. Tell me the question. The first question was...
It doesn't matter. The point is, the question was now framed so that I could ask it or dance around it and make it sound really accurate. So the first lady's question was about, what's your business going to be like? So again, in classic mentalist form, I did not just say, your question was about business, which would be stupid. You dance around it. And you say, I see you having something to do with people. You're a people person. And you see what I'm saying here? This is how they do it. You don't just blurt out the exact words from the question. Although today, we've seen people actually blurt out the question. And in fact, if you've seen Peter Popoff, he goes, you live at 2299 Elm Avenue in Arcadia, California. Am I right? I mean, what's up with that, you know? But he got away with it for years. All right, so the end of the story is, now that I've confessed, see, that's why my book is called Confessions of a Conflicted Medium. And it's called Psychic Blues because I love the artifice of what we're talking about. I love the carnival and the grease paint and all the bullshit that goes into it, but I don't like what it does to people. That's why I'm a skeptic. In other words, why can't we just talk to each other? Why do we have to pay a psychic? And why do we have to mix the supernatural with it? Why can't we just have a cup of coffee and you tell me what's going on with you and I'll tell you what I think? It's not socially acceptable, right? So we pay for these people to literally steal our money from us. And they tell us what we want to know instead of what we need to know. There's a huge difference between. So that's why I'm not completely against getting your palm read. I know skeptics are going to say, oh God, don't even go there. It's a Halloween ride, you know? It's an entertainment. I don't have a problem with that. But these things that we find ourselves in the middle of, and I truly believe this was 1997. This is why we've got what's going on in the world today. Because lying has now become an accepted business practice. It was accepted for these kind of things to go on. And I'm sure it has been for a long, long time. But the point is, you get what you pay for. So this company made $17 million, actually, before this. They lost money on this. Do you know why? Because people didn't like that they mixed religion with it. They put a little too much Christian symbolism into it. People didn't like it. So they sank. This sank and they went bankrupt. And it took me almost 6 months to get paid. And I barely got paid anything. I did not do this for the money. And they knew that because they knew what the other psychics were doing it to get more readings, to get more famous and have somebody, you know, so I could go on a TV show and say, oh, I'm booked all the way for the next 5 years. But I couldn't do it. I had a conscience. So is that pretty much?
So that's basically it. Everything's in the book. No, that's fine. Everything's in the book. Citing Blues and tons more. He's going to be making an audiobook of this with the music.
And here's again, it goes to the future we're in right now, because I could not get a publisher for this, because every publisher I went to, they said, we don't do fiction. And I'm like, this is not fiction. These things actually happen. So finally I found Feral House, which is a very interesting publisher, and they took it on, but they edited about a third of it out. A lot of the book that didn't get published was about what was going on in my life, the real me. They just wanted the dirt, and they wanted me to be a very unsavory character. So that's the way, if you buy my book and you read it, you're going to go, wow, what a scumbag. That's what they wanted. They wanted the anti-hero part to come out, so we played that up. But the audiobook is going to be the original manuscript, which is warts and all, everything, the influences, work through the magic castle, all that stuff. Is it going now?
No. So that, let's have like one.
Why did we do this?
We have one. Can we have like one or two quick questions? You can talk to Mark afterwards. If we want to get out, get the place cleaned up, and go eat.
I hope I didn't bring everybody down.
You were better.
The point is, we are skeptics because we live in an era that is now, we don't know what is real and what is not real anymore. And it's up to us to really seek some sort of a foundation and start over if we have to, because it's just gotten really out of hand. And my personal experience with this multi-million dollar business and the things that went on is just, it's like, I can't do anything about Trump or Pence or any of these people, but the bottom feeders like these people, that's what Susan and I go after, because their lying, it's just levels of lying. And there's really not much difference between an interrogation and a psychic reading now. It's all the same thing. So I hope I gave you at least something to think about. I have 3 copies of the book if anybody wants one, and any questions?
When is the audio version coming out?
When is it coming out? Probably sometime in this year. That's all I can say right now, because there's a lot of finagling that has to go on, not the least of which is getting... I've got an actual person who's going to read it now. It's a long story, but it will come out, and everybody who's involved with Susan or I will know about it, because it'll be on Audible or something like that. So, any other?